Hello and welcome to the Facebook worship service of the Good Shepherd United Methodist Church of North Fort Myers for November the 8th, 2020. I am Pastor Tom and Pastor Leah will be joining us shortly. Please leave your comments below and let us know that you are enjoying the service. You can share this service with your other friends on Facebook and other platforms as well. Announcements. We are having a turkey drive to be given to the Page Park community. We're doing this through a $20 donation that we are receiving here at the church by November the 15th. We will purchase the turkeys and deliver them, get them to Page Park. So that's by November the 15th, $20 for a turkey. Also, we are receiving canned goods, just a variety of canned goods. We're not doing the food baskets to this year, but we are just trying to fill their pantry down at Page Park so that they can then give the canned goods out to people as needed throughout the coming weeks. All Souls Episcopal Community Outreach Tuesday services needs volunteers. They also need pill bottles. So if you would be able to help out down at All Souls, we would certainly appreciate it. The group meets on Tuesday morning to prepare the things to be distributed, and then they are distributed to the people on Wednesday. Our small group study, When Christ Lives in Us, continues on Wednesday evenings at 7 p.m., always on Zoom. If you'd like to participate, just let the church office know and we'll add you in. We do still need some volunteers here at the church as we have resumed services to run the PowerPoint, to be designers of the PowerPoint, to help us run the sound booth and the other audio equipment, and to do some setup and takedown of chairs. We do have people who are willing to step up and help to develop a Saturday service, which would be on the East Patio. Very thankful to them. If you'd like to help out and be part of an outdoor Saturday evening, more of a Vespers informal type of worship service, we would certainly like to hear from you and would like to have your participation and help. The memorial service for John Stimson will be Wednesday, November the 11th at 2 p.m. in the worship center and on Zoom. So you do need to make a reservation with the church office so that we can know who is in the building and who will be receiving the Zoom link. John Stimson Memorial, November 11th at 2 p.m. The church office will be closed on Wednesday, November the 11th, as it is Veterans Day. We are going to be having a Thanksgiving worship service on Tuesday, November the 24th at 6 p.m. Please call the church office and make a reservation to attend that service. Invite your friends and neighbors. If we have more than 50 people, we'll go outside and have it out there. That would be a lovely opportunity for us to have lots of people come and to invite friends and neighbors to just a service of Thanksgiving in this time. We do need help delivering the 40 poinsettias to our 40 shut-ins and homebound folks. We also need others to donate for the poinsettias. $10 is each poinsettia. So make your checks payable to Good Shepherd and mark the donation as poinsettias. And we will make sure that we can give the poinsettias to the shut-in church members. The Handbell Choir always rehearses on Thursdays at 9 a.m. So if you're interested in that, please contact the church office or Shannon Arnold, and we can participate in that. I want to say a personal word of thanks for all the cards and the gifts of appreciation that I have received during Pastor's Appreciation Month. I certainly do feel your appreciation, and I am most grateful to you all. Thank you. Thank you very much. Tropical Storm Eta. Well, this is being recorded on Thursday, so I just want to encourage you to make the necessary preparations, listen to the media. We will be having worship services on Sunday, and remember that the church is never a shelter from a tropical storm. I'd like to invite Pastor Leah to come now and offer us words of welcome and affirmation and the psalm.
Hello, beautiful people of God. We welcome you to this service in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. As we enter into worship, I'd like to offer an affirmation to prepare our hearts. We come, O Lord, today to worship you with joy, to give you all honor and glory, God our Creator. We come to worship with thanksgiving for all the many blessings we have received already. We come seeking your voice and your message, seeking a word of love, a word of peace, a word of healing for our lives and for our nation. We come, Lord, to offer our prayers to you, to ask for forgiveness for our sins. We declare that we are faithful disciples of Jesus Christ, and we come to worship him, seeking his face, seeking Jesus' presence and power. We declare that Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior. We come as we are. We hope to leave this place changed and transformed into better disciples. Come, Holy Spirit of God. You are welcome in this place. Amen. Let us praise God in the presentation and hearing of the beautiful hymn, Seek Ye First the Kingdom of God. The psalm for this week is Psalm 78. My people, hear my teachings. Listen to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth with a parable. I will utter hidden things, things from of old, things we have heard and known, things our ancestors have told us. We will not hide them from their descendants. We will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, his power and the wonders he has done. God decreed statutes for Jacob and established the law in Israel, which he commanded our ancestors to teach their children, so the next generation would know them, even the children yet to be born. And they in turn would tell their children. Then they would put their trust in God and would not forget his deeds, but would keep his commands Amen. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
We come to our time of joys and concerns. Please be aware that the information that I'm sharing now is the most current available on Thursday. By the time you view this, things may have changed, so please be sensitive and appreciate that we are always receiving prayer requests, and as soon as they are received, I and others are in prayer for you. Arlene Fenn has been diagnosed with breast cancer and is asking for prayers for strength and recovery. Carolyn Dobson had a heart procedure and she is now home and doing better. Nan Walsh had surgery to repair her left ankle. She is recovering. Sue Nagel has been going through many tests locally for cancer. She'll be going up to Tampa to the Moffitt Cancer Center and then on as well to Shands Hospital in Gainesville. Christy Kohler is still awaiting a definitive diagnosis and treatment plan for issues involving her thyroid. Charlotte Ohm's grandnephew, Chris Schott, is very ill and has been told that he is coming to the close of his life. Chris is a young man with two young children. We want to also pray for his wife, Nicole, in this very difficult time and for the entire family. Donna and John Michelle ask for prayers for Mary Jo Bowman, who is a friend of theirs in Ohio, who has been diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. She is 82 years old. Mike and Sherry Morrissey are pastors and missionaries in Thailand. They recently sent a note to Bob Struhl seeking prayers. Our prayers for their daughter, Rachel Morrissey. Rachel has many health complications since she was involved in a terrible car accident several years ago. We want to pray strongly for her recovery from this series of health issues and also for her parents, for their hope and strength and endurance in these trying times. Let us join our hearts together now in the pastoral prayer and also together in the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we pause now to marvel and to celebrate at your presence, your power, and the purpose that you give to each of us. We recognize that your presence is so amazing, so fulfilling, so energizing, so calming. Forgive us, Lord, for we are a stubborn and impatient people. We always want to know how things are going to end, even before we are willing to begin. We want to know what the schedule is. Grant us peace and assurance in our daily preparations. Enable us to seek the Holy Spirit, who has been given to comfort and to guide us, that you, Lord, may be our daily planner, not our little books. Daily we are called to come before you in prayer and praise. Daily we are challenged by your Holy Spirit to find ways to serve your people in your world. Daily you grant us the oil of grace and reconciliation, which we so desperately need to keep our lamps filled and ready. But we still would like to know when. We still want to know how and where, so that we can have the oil for our lamps. Lord, help us to place you at the center of our lives. Enable us to seek to daily prepare ourselves for your coming again in glory. We have brought before you the names of those people who are near and dear to us, and we ask your healing love and blessings to be upon them. Their needs are great, and our abilities are limited. But we know that with your love, all things are possible. We pray now for those from whom we are estranged, and those whom we might even call an enemy or an opponent. We pray for reconciliation. We ask humbly for your grace to mend our relationships, to heal the brokenness that is between us. We pray for the mending of our country and of this world. Bless our political and religious leaders, that we may all seek to follow your will and know your direction for our lives, our churches, and our country. Give us such courage and perseverance that we may faithfully proclaim your love to all of creation. Make us ready to receive you now, in this place and every place where we are. For it is in Jesus' name that we pray and offer now the prayer your Son, our Savior Jesus, taught us to say together: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you to remember to share the gifts that God has provided to you in the support of our ministry here at Good Shepherd. It is very important. We rely on your generosity and your support to take Jesus' name out in the community in many, many ways. Let us now receive this offering of music with the song, He.
That makes sense.
Scripture lesson for today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, the 25th chapter, verses 1 through 13. At that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish, and 5 were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps, but did not take any oil with them. The wise ones, however, took oil in jars along with their lamps. The bridegroom was a long time in coming, and they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, the cry rang out, "Here's the bridegroom! Come out to meet him!" Then all the virgins woke up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish ones said to the wise, "Give us some oil for our lamps. Our lamps are going out." "No," they replied, "there may not be enough for both us and you. Instead, go to those who sell oil and buy some for yourselves." But while they were on their way to buy the oil, the bridegroom arrived. The virgins who were ready went in with him to the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the others also came. "Lord, Lord," they said, "open the door for us." But he replied, "Truly I tell you, I don't know you. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So today's sermon is titled, "Can You Spare Some Oil? Can You Spare Some Oil?" Today's text makes a shift in the focus and in the context of Jesus' words. Jesus now moves out of the temple and on to the Mount of Olives. He begins the scriptural part of Matthew called the eschatological discourses. In other words, it's the speeches about the end of time. And we're going to read the whole 25th chapter of Matthew over the coming 3 weeks. So we'll hear this whole discourse. These words build upon each other as Jesus tries to explain the kingdom of God and the end of time. I hope you're able to hear the whole chapter over the coming weeks. Now, sharing is a good thing until it's kind of like the last and only thing. And let me explain. At that time, which means the end of times, as well as these times, it's both places. The kingdom of God, which is also here and now, but is also there and then, will be like, a parable is coming, 10 young bridesmaids who took their lamps. Oh, isn't that a beautiful idea? Beautiful image, a time of celebration. It's well known to all in Jesus' time and even in our times today. The bridesmaid's mission was to accompany the groom into the wedding banquet hall. They would bring the groom in to meet the bride and the rest of the bride's family at the wedding party. The lamps and the torches were used to light the path along the way at night, often as they made this procession. Now, as readers, we know who is wise and foolish because they've already been identified. But do they actually know in the midst of the story who is wise and who is foolish? Well, they all fall asleep because the groom is late. Aren't they always? All 10 fall asleep because of the delayed groom's arrival. Now the groom finally does arrive, and everyone must get ready for the great procession. Well, this is where the point of the problem really becomes evident. Everyone must prepare their lamps to accomplish their mission. Yet 5 did not bring oil. They only brought their lamps. 5 have oil to keep their lamps supplied for the full parade, but only enough for themselves. If they share, everyone will run out of oil. No one will have light to make it all the way to the wedding banquet. Their all will then be lost. This is why they refuse to share. They're not being mean or rude or trying to hoard for themselves. They have actually counted the full measure of the task of the mission that for which they are responsible. They are being faithful to their assignment as bridesmaids, which is to accompany the groom to the wedding banquet. They have a specific responsibility, a clear mission. Jesus isn't simply teaching about proper wedding etiquette and about people who make wise preparations and people who make foolish preparations for great parties. Jesus is speaking about the kingdom of God. Realize that the groom is Jesus. The bridesmaids are all disciples waiting to join the procession of Jesus to the great wedding banquet, which is an ancient image for the end of times banquet in the fully realized kingdom of God. Now, if Jesus comes and says, "Let's go," disciples better be sure that they're ready to go. Nothing will stop the grand final procession into the kingdom of God. Jesus waits for no one when the final trumpet is sounded. That is called judgment. Now, the depth of the foolishness of the 5 bridesmaids is made clear when they actually accept the advice of others to go seek more oil. Well, sure, they can find more oil. And yes, they do return to the banquet hall, but they have not participated in the procession. They have not accomplished their mission. So now they're failed bridesmaids, but yet they still expect admittance to the wedding feast. The saddest words ever to hear from our Lord will be, "I tell you the truth, I don't know you. I tell you the truth, I don't know you." The wisdom teaching from this is summed up clearly in the next verse. What do you do? "Therefore, keep alert, because you don't know the day or the hour." Now, I don't think this is just about a group of folks with a poor sense of timing. I think this is really about alert, wise, and prudent preparation and the consequences of our attention or inattention to our mission as disciples of Jesus Christ. Now, I'm sure some of you at this point are saying, "Well, Pastor, what about grace? What about grace? Doesn't Jesus just love everybody? Won't he let them all in? You got to understand what grace is. Grace is the oil. Grace is the oil. The foolish bridesmaids did not seek oil. They came unprepared. They pretended by simply having lamps without oil. They just showed up with their lamps. Hello, I'm here. Love me. They didn't ever bring oil. They had gotten their lamps, they'd gotten all the outward appearances, they were so nice and ready to go, but they had not prepared the oil, which is a long process. It's a lifetime. You see, that is the work of grace. It's realized in discipleship. That's how it all works together. Grace is freely given, but to disciples who participate, who engage, who follow Jesus Christ, not just sitting around, who follow Jesus Christ. Grace requires our efforts, our attention, our intention. Grace is for living as a disciple of Jesus Christ. It's not to get a free pass because we're some kind of lazy pretender. So how do we keep alert? How do we keep alert? Well, I think the first thing is to realize that, yes, there is going to be a final judgment. If you always remember that, not to be scared about it, but just know that there is going to be a final judgment, that Jesus is coming back. Nobody knows when, so we are always to be prepared. Don't wait until the last minute. Don't try to guess when he's going to show up and just get ready right before that. Be prepared. Do you have lamp oil? Or are you just holding an empty lamp? Second thing. What is that oil? That oil is grace. So you have to prepare grace. You have to participate for grace. Which is to say, read and live the scriptures. Experience repentance. Know forgiveness. Share mercy. Live as a disciple every day and develop a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. That is the fountain of oil. Third, when did you last make an inventory of your preparations? Are you really practicing today your Christian discipleship? Or are you counting on, I've been a good Christian back then over there, and I'm just kind of going to, you know, phone it all in from here on out. I'm retired. I can take it easy. What's the current condition of your Christian character? How are things with your soul? Now, we can judge ourselves. I'm not going to judge anybody. I'm not going to point fingers. I'm not going to say, here's a list, go take care of this business. That's not my job. But I can judge myself. I can hold myself accountable. I can ask other people to help me. And I can ask myself, am I wise? Or am I foolish? Fourth thing, are we aware of our missional priorities? That mission is to follow Jesus. Every single day, all day long, we are to be ready to join the wedding banquet at any moment. Or are we counting on other folks to cover for us? Doesn't work. Once the preparation leaves, there is no late coming. There's no excuses accepted at the door. There's no rain checks. Jesus, who who is the groom, did not put the bridesmaids out. They arrived too late. They were not ready. It was by their actions preceding the bridal procession that revealed their foolishness. They ignored grace. So the judgment, being locked out, being unrecognized, was simply the result of their previous actions. Jesus wasn't being mean. Jesus was being just and true. The foolish bridesmaids failed in their mission, in their preparation. You see, God's judgment is perfect, and it is based on our faithful attention to our discipleship, to our participation, to our service, to our actions over time, to our relationship with Jesus Christ. Our discipleship is our path of preparation. God is not arbitrary. God is not mean-spirited. God is not spiteful, checking off on little boxes who's in and who's out. We decide that by not seeking His grace, by not having oil in our lamps. Judgment is simply the result. Those who are ready and follow enter the banquet. The rest are not able to enter. There's no exceptions. There's no ifs, ands, or buts. So what can we do? We can follow Jesus by the power of His Holy Spirit every single day. We can remain faithful in all situations and at all times and places. We can obey God's word. We can obey Jesus' calling in our lives. We can truly be His disciples, and we can keep the mission. We can remain on mission with Jesus. Therefore, keep alert, because you don't know the day or the hour. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.
Friends, hear the words from 2 Chronicles 7:14. Familiar words, but very true to what the Lord asks of us. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. Amen. Receive the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Shalom. Go in peace.